Today, we wrap up round two on the road to the Final Four. Our tournament tour takes off in the beautiful capital city of Atlanta, where East Region action opens with St. John's of the Big East against Duke of the Atlantic Coast Conference. The Blue Devils have enjoyed fiendish success under Mike Krzyzewski, and today he sends out another team that is talented and tournament tough. Up Tobacco Road in Richmond, there's another Big East ACC showdown, Virginia against Syracuse. Cavalier coach Terry Holland will retire after this season, and Derek Coleman will try to hasten his departure. Then we'll swing through the city that bills itself as the crossroads of America. Midwest action, Texas and Purdue. Tom Penders has a reputation for tournament upsets, so Gene Cady and his Boilermakers will need to forge their iron discipline into corralling the Longhorns. Back in Atlanta for the second game, UCLA meets Kansas. Trevor Wilson conducts the Bruins' up-tempo attack, and he'll match up against Ricky Callaway of the second-seeded Jayhawks. Back in Richmond, Northern Iowa, the Cinderella story will try to keep the ball alive.
Unable to get inside.
Oh, Newby.
Tournament track takes us back to Indy as we speed ahead with Xavier and Georgetown. Alonzo Mourning alone is dangerous, but he's paired with Dikembe Mutombo, creating a tall order for the Musketeers. Finally, the road winds west. We're on the shores of the Pacific. Defending champion Michigan will be challenged by emotionally charged Loyola Marymount. 2 weeks ago today, Hank Gathers died of heart failure. Now his teammates have dedicated this tournament to his memory. Before this day is done, only 16 teams will be left to carry on the road to the Final Four.
Hello, everyone. I'm Jim Nance, along with Mike Francesa, as we continue to navigate our way along the winding road to the Final Four. You know, Mike, if yesterday's games are any yardstick of what we might expect today, then the basketball fans are in for a big day again.
We lost three of the top 16 seeds yesterday, four for the tournament in all, and seven, all twos and threes, who played today. For them, a word, caution, it won't be easy.
All right. You know, there was an exhilarating stretch of games yesterday afternoon. Let's show you once again, starting out with what happened to one seed Oklahoma.
They'll come through Davis, and he'll come to Fox. Fox comes down the baseline and hits it. Carolina wins it! Carolina upsets OU!
There was a simultaneous Cinderella unfolding in Salt Lake City. Ball State led by as much as 17 in the second half, but Louisville fought back and had a chance to win it at the buzzer. Meantime, back in Austin, Dayton and Arkansas were tied, closing seconds. The Razorbacks' Todd Day followed up his own miss and scored. Still, the Flyers had one last shot.
Howard throws it up high. Ball is free. Arkansas advances. It'll be Arkansas and North Carolina with an appointment in Dallas.
I'm just glad that we were able to pull that one off. It's a big victory for us. We're in the Sweet 16, and we've still got a chance.
Another last-second outcome in Knoxville. Kenny Anderson put Georgia Tech up in the final minute and then held on.
Against this one, LSU needs a three to send it to overtime.
They got to get up on them and don't let them just advance the ball real quick.
Here's the finish. Williamson, no good. Georgia Tech makes the Sweet 16.
Meanwhile, for LSU sophomore sensation Chris Jackson, it would be his final welcome home to Baton Rouge.
Chris has an announcement that he will make, and there will be no more questions accepted on this announcement, so please have respect.
I've just decided that I will enter the 1990 draft this year. I feel it's time for me to move on.
No more suspense from Chris Jackson. He's turning pro. Right now, we're approaching game time down in Atlanta, St. John's against Duke. Dick Stockton and Hubie Brown will have that action when the road to the Final Four continues after this word from your local station.
And welcome to the Omni in Atlanta, Georgia, for second round action in the East Region. And as you look at these four schools here in Atlanta remaining, St. John's, Duke, UCLA, and Kansas, you won't find a region that is more steeped in NCAA championship tradition than these four schools, and they battle today for the right to move on. In game one, it'll be the St. John's Redmen against the Blue Devils of Duke University. Stockton, and both of these schools stumble toward the end of the regular season and in their respective conference tournaments. St. John's, for example, they lost a great player, a big weapon in Jason Williams, and they lost him in mid-January. But both of these schools seem to have found new life, and leading St. John's is senior guard Boo Harvey, and he has won a lot of games down the stretch for the Redmen this year. And Hubie Brown, what role will Boo Harvey have to play today if the Redmen are pulling upset?
Well, Coach Lou Conoseca wants a game in the 60s. The catalyst that is Boo. Boo must break down the pressure in the backcourt and then milk the clock. He's a distributor today, but most of all, he must score big. St. John's front line, very critical. They need the minutes from the big three and the point production.
So Boo's got to be big. That's the one thing we know. As far as Duke is concerned, they dropped four of their last six games. And this week, Phil Henderson, their co-captain, blasted the teammates. They said they were a bunch of babies, and they could have responded either way, but they seemed to have done the right thing, and it was evident in the victory over Richmond. Now, what do you think Duke's plan is today against a challenge from St. John?
Well, this is a ball club that's built on defense. It's tradition with them. They feel that their defense is as good as anyone's in the country. Now, that kind of faded in the last six regular season ball games for them, but it's back now. They feel the intensity to be there. They run off it. At the offensive end of the floor, the power game. The two big 6'10 guys, wide bodies, down inside, can get the big scores for you. And then you have the slasher, Henderson, capable of getting 25 to 30. Well-rounded ball club.
You know, Mike Krzyzewski, the coach at Duke, used to be an Army in the early coaching time of Lou Conoseca at St. John's. Both of them have a friendship. There is a warmth and an unmistakable liking between the two, as you'll see right here.
I've hated his taste in sweaters, loved his taste in food. And he's been a guy that when we used to go to those luncheons in Mama Leone's, I always was jealous of him because he could speak Italian and get much better food than the Polish people who attended those luncheons.
You could see right away it was going to be a hard-nosed coach. I can remember we had better material at St. John's, and we really struggled. I mean, that guy was always in your pocket. I'm not talking about a Willie Sutton. I'm talking defensively, of course.
Love the answer. Love the answer. The lunches are dynamite. They create this. Hey, the intensity when they coach against one another, but fun on Mondays.
How many people remember who Willie Sutton is? That's another story. All right, we're set to go. So far, this region has gone according to form, and both of these teams won handily in their first game. So it'll be St. John's and Duke getting set for the introduction of the starting lineups when we return.
CBS Sports coverage of the NCAA Basketball Championship is sponsored by Budweiser, the king of beers. Remember, know when to say when. The good time, great taste of McDonald's. And by today's Chevrolet, who invite you to see why nobody's winning like the heartbeat of America.
Atlanta, they're very happy over Georgia Tech's victory over LSU last night, which you saw on CBS. The largest city of the eight hosting the first two rounds in this NCAA championship. St. John's against Duke. And now for the starting lineups, our public address announcer, Marshall Mann.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the Omni in Atlanta for today's second round East Region game between the St. John's Redmen and the Duke Blue Devils. And now let's meet the starting lineups. For St. John's, at forward, a 6'8 sophomore from the Bronx, New York, number 21, Malik Seeley. For Duke, at forward, a 6'5 senior from Fayetteville, North Carolina, number 21, Robert Bricky. For St. John's, at forward, a 6'7 junior from the Bronx, New York, number 33, Billy Singleton. For Duke, at forward, a 6'11 sophomore from Angola, New York, number 32, Christian Leitner. for St. John's at center, a 6'11 sophomore from Sunnyside, New York, number 41, Robert Werdan. For Duke at center, a 6'10 senior from Bloomfield, New Jersey, number 30, Ala Abdelnaby. For St. John's at guard, a 6-foot senior from St. Albans, New York, number 3, Greg Boo Harvey. For Duke at guard, a 6-4 senior from University Park, Illinois, number 3, Phil Henderson. For St. John's at guard, a 6'2 sophomore from Syracuse, New York, number 12, Jason Buchanan. For Duke at guard, a 6-foot freshman from Jersey City, New Jersey, number 11, Bobby Hurley. And introducing the head coaches, for St. John's in his 22nd season, Lou Carnaseca. For Duke in his 10th season, Mike Krzyzewski.
Mike Krzyzewski, nattily dressed as he always is, and of course, Louis Carnaseca in that sweater, and has brought him a lot of good luck. Ready for the opening tip between the Redmen and the Blue Devils when we come back to Atlanta in just a moment. Ready for the opening tip-off, Mike Tanko from Dallas, Texas, Ron Zetcher from St. Louis, Missouri, and Charlie Range out of Fremont, California are the officials working today in the second round action underway. Duke controls, Darren White, St. John's in red.
Duke is a motion type of an offense, high-low with the big people, Abdelnaby and Layton.
And a steal, turnover off the top. Boo Harvey puts up the first shot of the game, and it's tipped up by Malik Sealy, Werdan. Duke coming down with the ball after St. John's had three chances.
Both teams today are primarily man-to-man ball clubs.
Early, the freshman from Jersey City, guarded by Harvey, the senior. Phil Henderson with a three, starts the scoring in the game.
That was interesting. They went away from the motion and gave a double screen on the baseline that time for Henderson.
St. John's has not gotten past the second round since they went to the Final Four 6 years ago. Singleton's shot is missed, and Abdelnaby, tied up with Malik Sealy in the possession arrow, will favor the Redmen.
If St. John's is going to get the job done today, they have got to crash the boards and then keep the people blocked out.
Harvey misses the rebound by Henderson. Duke has a big edge in depth on the Redmen today, which we'll see early.
Well, Duke keeps running at you with a ton of talent.
Christian Leitner, top of the key. Werdan. Big thing for St. John's is Werdan to avoid foul trouble. He was used to the six personals in the Big East. Only gets five today.
Well, this is the pace that St. John's loves.
Jason Buchanan, who had a big game against Temple. Right now, St. John's is ice cold, but Werdan with a follow-up pass.
I'm impressed early, Dick. St. John's now has four offensive rebounds, doing a very nice job.
And we'll have a whistle and a foul. Christian Leitner of the Blue Devils. Lou Carnaseca, 65 years old, told us yesterday, I feel good, I enjoy the game. Most of all, I love going to practice.
That's the key.
You have to love the practice sessions, Dick. Come on.
That's the real test, huh?
Absolutely. That's where the creativity goes, and you spend the hours on top of hours trying to get the right chemistry.
Singleton pipes in, so Billy Singleton, only 6'7", but a good strong man inside.
Yeah, he's a banger, you know, really well-proportioned upper body. He's the key in this game today, I think. I feel if he gets double figures, you got to watch out.
Pass inside, tipped away by Sealy, and another turnover. Duke has turned over two thus far. St. John's with a one-point lead. Sealy misses an open baseline jumper. Werdan gets it back.
I think St. John's is kind of fooling Duke early. You know, they're pushing the ball and looking for that quick shot.
Buchanan pulls away, rebound by Leitner, outlet pass to Bricky. Only back to defend is Harvey, and Harvey commits the foul, and going down hard is Robert Bricky.
Well, boo right over there. You know, that's a bump. You don't want a guy to get an easy layup in this situation. Put him on the foul line, make him make two foul shots.
First substitution coming into the game will be a freshman, That's Thomas Hill from Lancaster, Texas, a good defensive player, and he'll replace Ala Abdelnaby. Bricky will be at the free throw line. He's a 6'5 senior from Fayetteville, North Carolina. Missed 8 games with a knee injury, but now is back to 100%.
He's one of their true team leaders. He's outspoken. Mike was concerned about the senior leadership this year at the beginning of the season. The fellas have all stepped forward, garnered an awful lot of respect, and they, in return, love their coach. They say that we have an open-door policy here. You can speak what you want, and it's amazing how much Coach K backs you up.
1 out of 2 for Bricky. How do you like the ACC so far? Undefeated at 8-0 in the tournament.
I guess that's impressive.
Right. You're right. This was not supposed to be a good year for the Atlantic Coast Conference.
Now, Duke is in a 2-2-1 now. Full court press. They've been working on it now for the last 2 weeks, getting prepared to tournament time. Now, why do you do this? You want to waste some time on the clock, force a couple of possible untimely shots. But more important, get you out of your half-court offense.
Turnover is where Dan stepped on the line. It was interesting that Krzyzewski told us yesterday, he says, I know St. John's, without a deep team, cannot really practice because they don't have the people to work the press.
Yeah, but, you know, Uncle Louie, come on. Uncle Louie's been playing 7 guys forever at St. John's.
They get it inside. Hill. Leitner saves it in the corner. And they're going to call possession. It'll still be Duke ball. Leitner goes out of the game, replaced by Abdelnaby. He's a 6'10 senior from Bloomfield. Did not start against Richmond. His first non-start of the season. They wanted to go with a smaller lineup.
And it worked to their advantage, and Abdel had a great ball game.
Hurley with a good feed in to Thomas Hill.
See, if I'm coaching St. John's today, I want to see Hurley, when he breaks the lane, shoot the shot. Don't let him dish off to the other people for easy layups. Make him think offense first in regards to scoring.
Verdane hits a good inside-outside pass from Singleton to Robert Verdane. And we're tied at 6.
Verdane, Seeley, and Boo Harvey must have big games. And in Singleton helping them out today from offense.
Pesky defense by St. John's. Ball drops for Bricky to break the tie. Redmond looks like they're trying to push it up to midcourt quickly.
Well, you see, they have such incredible confidence in Boo Harvey that he can break down any guard in the country and take him. 5-second call. You see Hurley right here now taking Harvey. Now he's within the 6 feet, see, and the count is going on. This is one of the very few times this season that I've seen Boo Harvey go side to side rather than north to south and penetrate.
Hurley trying to get past Harvey, gets into the lane. Abdelnaby had it. Still Duke ball. Double team on Abdelnaby. He's tucked inside. He scored 22 points and had 12 rebounds off the bench against Richmond.
He's very confident in that move, Dick. I expect him to be able to get that shot all day.
High pass. Buchanan found Seeley inside. And this is a high-paced game, a little higher scoring than Parnasecki would like, I would think.
Well, he's over there right now, you know, orchestrating everything.
Hill. They call him country. He's got that Texas twang, and that's the way his teammates look upon him. And Thomas Hill, the freshman, has already made an impact since coming in off the bench.
Well, you've got to get out and play to Duke, guys. You can't give up an easy 12 to 15-foot shot because of the type of athlete that they have. They all can knock that down.
5 minutes going by in the first half. Harvey trying to find the range. This is again. So far, St. John's ice cold from the perimeter. Here is Hurley's lead pass to Bricky. He'll get another shot at it. And it's 14-8 now in favor of Duke.
This is where St. John's has got to watch out now, because they all look down the floor. That was a heads-up play by Hurley, and Duke is constantly out there looking for the easy layup.
Timeout called by St. John's. Back here in Atlanta, Dick Stockton and Hubie Brown. Duke leading 14-8. St. John's calling a timeout. Redmond will go with 7 men at the most. And Duke already deep into the bench. Bobby Hurley, the freshman. Boo Harvey, already the father of two, the senior for St. John's. Verdane with a hook short, Leitner clear. Here's Hurley, 2-on-2 break for Duke. And Hurley foul against the Redmen. It'll be Boo Harvey, his first. Make it his second personal foul. That's the last man that Karnaseca could lose. Mike Krzyzewski said he came into the tournament saying some teams just look to get to the next round. We're looking well beyond that. We want to get another Final Four. They've been there three of the last 4 years.
Well, it's the history of the program. In the last 7 years, they're averaging right around 20-some-odd wins a year. And you know that this guy on the foul line for you right now is going to dictate the pace. He's going to dictate the tempo. But Coach K says the major hang-up with Hurley right now is that he's always looking to give up the ball. He would rather him be more positive and think shot a little bit when he gets down inside of the lane.
And that's why he thinks he'll be a scorer eventually. Here's the pressure. Three-quarter by the Blue Devils. Buchanan in trouble. Werdan finds Seeley.
JFB, the big question mark today is every time they see that trap and they get it over half court, do you attack and try to get the numbers for the layup, or do you back it out? Now, if you keep backing it out, now you're playing Duke's game because they have nothing to lose by staying in the trap.
Singleton inside was doubled and gets the shot. So that's the second basket inside by Billy Singleton, who averaged 10 during the year.
I know St. John's is down six, but I'm impressed with the type of shots that they're getting. They're getting what they want.
Henderson, this is a three. He hit one to start the game. The Redmen on a 4-on-2 break. Buchanan just inside the three-point line hits one. Now, Buchanan hit a bunch of threes against Temple. And don't forget, St. John's trailing now by four. It's been ice cold thus far from the field.
Like you say, when you're coaching at any level, if you're getting the shots that you want, you don't get upset. They just got to take their time to knock them in.
Hurley with a good spin move in the lane. His first field goal of the game. Winding down to 7 minutes going by in the opening half. Duke leading by six. Leitner is all over Werdan. There's a great pass into Seeley and a five-out pass and a foul as well after the basket.
That was a great backdoor by Malik Seeley from the corner. An outstanding pass. Look to the right of your screen right now. Beautiful bounce pass. Seeley gets it and takes the ball up and in. Now, what a terrific compliment. Coach Luke Onoseca paid Seeley yesterday by saying that he's coached a lot of great players over the years with the Nets in the ABA and at St. John's, and he puts Malik Seeley, this young man on the line right now, as one of the five headiest players. And when you put Chris Mullin and Rick Barry and Mark Jackson and people of that nature.
George Johnson, I think, was the other one.
Yes, outstanding.
Foul was on Thomas Hill. Three-point lead for Duke. Each team with two team fouls. Abdel-Nabi coming off the screen by Leitner. Egyptian board a la Abdel-Nabi, always a scorer. Now has been a lot more under control this season.
I like Abdel's game. He's looking offensively, and you know he's so big and strong that he, in this tournament, he's been shooting over people.
Seeley bangs into Abdel-Nabi and lost the ball out of bounds. Into the game now for Duke is Bill McCaffrey. He's a freshman guard from Allentown, Pennsylvania, and a fine shooter. Basically, Duke will use three guards, Hurley, Henderson, and McCaffrey. You can play either role in the backcourt. Right now, he's the off guard, Hurley the point guard. Goes right around Harvey. Bounce pass, out of bounds, last touch by Duke.
See, Hurley has demonstrated early here now in the first 8 minutes that he has the confidence to beat Buhari off the dribble almost at will.
Coming into the game, the line was that he might have his hands full with Harvey. That may not be the way it turns out. Buchanan working against McCaffrey. Here's Werdan. Buchanan misses a three. McCaffrey the rebound. Duke is playing extremely tight defense against St. John's. 5-point lead for Duke. Batted away. Blocked by Malik Seeley as Hurley tried to sneak inside, and a timeout called here at the Omni in the first. We're at the Omni in Atlanta, Georgia for the second round action here in this half of the East Region bracket. Duke leading St. John's 20-15, nearly halfway through this opening half. Dick Stockton and Hubie Brown as you look at the St. John's band.
Key matchup in this game, Dick, is Singleton on Ala. Ala Del Navi can get that shot up over the top of him. He's given him too many inches, and he's primarily a low post scout.
Leitner traveled. He got a good pass from McCaffrey and another turnover. That is the sixth against Duke already in this first half.
I like the St. John's defense. They're doing a good job, but they must button up on Hurley and stop the penetration, or they're going to be in for a long night.
Now, everyone was concerned on the St. John's side of Wardan getting into foul trouble. So far, he's avoided it, but Boo Harvey has picked up two personals. Wardan out on the perimeter. It's Abdel Nabi, knocked away by Leitner. Hurley saves not in time, and it's still St. John's ball. In the other section of the regional here in the East, University of Connecticut and Clemson were victorious yesterday. Clemson with a great comeback against LaSalle. Four Big Ten, four Big East teams remain, and the Atlantic Coast Conference has been unbeaten. Harvey's shot is blocked by Hurley.
Excellent, excellent position defensively. Quick feet by Hurley.
Leitner against Wardan. Won't mind if he picks up some fouls, but a good defense that time by Wardan. Lead pass to Buchanan. Still a five-point Duke lead.
Run it for St. John's. They've got airs to go.
Ceiling,
right,
and that's the exact same play as they ran before on the baseline pass, Buchanan to Malik Sealy, who now has seven.
See, Malik has not had the opportunity to handle the ball much, but he's running real well without the ball. Backdooring his man.
Ricky goes in unmolested. He just went right around Sealy as if he wanted it.
Wow, big breakdown defensively that time. Word did. Lost contact and did not see the offensive player off the dribble.
22-17, Duke. Blue Devils coming in 25-8 on the season.
Duke defense keeps pushing you further out and further out. They're constantly denying the next pass.
Buchanan trying to penetrate, finds Wardan, and another good pass. Jason Buchanan has really thread the needle on several occasions thus far.
Well, the Big East prepares you. There's so many changing defenses in that league that you must have a backdoor game. And we're seeing St. John's get the easy lay.
McCaffrey. Ricky. Bounces it to Leitner. Wardan stopped him and it's tipped up and no. They call offensive interference. Wardan made a fine block on Christian Leitner inside, and it'll be St. John's ball into the game for Duke now. Greg Kubek, a 6'6 junior from Clifton Park, New York. He is a forward who can also play some guard. And Brian Davis, sophomore from Capitol Heights, Maryland, a 6'6 forward guard combination. Guarding Buchanan. Hurley has done a good job on Harvey. Still Redmond ball.
See, that was a perfect example of Duke trying to deny the next closest pass. Now, the problem with all that is that when that guy fakes like he's coming out and changes direction on you, you're really vulnerable to the backdoor pass.
Hurley's really made life miserable for Boo Harvey. Fine pass into Malik Sealy. Too far under the basket. And a foul will be called against St. John's. And it'll be Robert Wardan with his first of the game.
That's good hustle, though. Wardan going in there trying to keep the offensive glass alive.
Robert Wardan. That's his first game.
Duke's lead is free. They were up by eight early on, forcing Carnesecca to call a timeout.
This is Duke's small lineup now. They're very small, but quick.
Ricky working in, getting a piece of it with Sealy. Wardan with a rebound. Buchanan has Harvey and Sealy. Pulls up. There was an opportunity for St. John's. They had a three-on-one.
Anytime you're three-on-one, you've got to give the basketball up because you will get the ball back for a layup.
To go in the first half. Duke has led all the way in this one. Henderson has it knocked away by Buchanan, and it was last touched by Henderson, so another turnover.
See, they're pests today, St. John. I like what they're doing defensively. They're doing an excellent job.
Their problem comes on the offensive end because Duke, as you say, keeps extending that man-to-man.
Yeah, but so far they're reading it pretty good.
Turn it over to the Blue Devils. Luke Karnaseca, St. John's Redmond, 24-9 on the season. Finished 6-6 after a tremendous start. Loss of Jason Williams really hurt this team.
Yes, with Jason in there, they could match up with almost any team in this country. What did Lou say yesterday? We could get in the ring with you.
That's right. Davis misses. Missing a tip was Kubek. And it's still Duke ball.
Where Dan and Singleton must continue to block out, but get on the board and hold Duke to one shot opportunity here.
Henderson shooting over Buchanan. Good defense by Buchanan. Henderson now with 5 points. And again, the Blue Devils by five. See where Duke starts picking up at midcourt, man-to-man all the way.
See, by giving the ball to Buchanan, you're giving Drew Harvey a chance to rest a little bit, but they're also trying to get him on the wing to get him involved in the offense. Get him the ball now and let him try to break down or be the recipient of a pass.
Here's Singleton. Going in strong, the basket. Now they've changed it. One official called the basket good, and the other one said no, an offensive foul. And that'll be the way it goes against Billy Singleton. And a timeout has been called. And the Omni here in Atlanta. Later on, it'll be UCLA against Kansas. Right here, St. John's and Duke, with the Blue Devils leading with 7:37 to go in the first half. At the conclusion of every NCAA tournament game, we will select the Chevrolet players of the game. In conjunction with the award, Chevrolet will donate $1,000 to the general scholarship fund of both schools. Bobby Hurley's been there all the way game for the Blue Devils at point guard. Sean Muto has replaced Robert Werdan in the St. John's lineup. He's a junior from Mechanicsburg, PA, and a 6'11 banger. They're just looking for help out here, Buchanan. Harvey has not scored yet in the game. That's what the Redmen need from him, besides all the other things. Fired that one up recklessly in the rebound into the hands now of Hurley.
Yeah, Harvey got hit on the arm on that shot, Dick, and he looked at the referee for the call.
Now Seeley for the Redmen, 26-19. Duke's biggest lead was 8 in this first half. 6:35 remain.
Hurley has done a terrific job on Harvey, not letting him go right to the hole.
Malik Seeley in the lane. He's the leading scorer for the Redmen at 18 points a game, and Seeley now has 9.
See, he's a tough cover for Duke right now. They're having problems matching up with him. He's been running extremely well off the ball, but he's had very few catches to do something off the dribble.
Abdullahi posting up against Singleton with a big height advantage. A 3-inch edge on Singleton, and Abdullahi burns him.
They can wear that matchup out all day long, Dick. And then that would open up their outside game.
Harvey goes up and is fouled by Hurley, the first time we've seen Boo try to take Hurley to the hoop. And he'll go to the line to shoot. Foul is on Bobby Hurley. That's his first. And the 13th foul against Duke. Robert Werdan comes back in the game along with Chucky Sproling. He's a sophomore from Denver at 6'6". He can play guard and off guard. Hasn't shot that much. They expect him to shoot a little better, but he's a good defensive player.
They think he'll block.
Seeley. Foul. No basket. And another Duke foul.
See, Muto should have allowed that shot. Once you hear the whistle, allow the ball that's over the rim the opportunity of maybe catching the outside of the rim and pulling itself back into the basket.
So the two substitutions by Karnaseca will be just about all you'll see for most of this game for the Redmen. Here's Malik Seeley on the line shooting 2.
Malik is blessed with outstanding talent. He's one of the most coachable players that Lou Karnaseca has had it during his famous career at St. John's. He said he's very cerebral. He understands everything that you're talking about. sees the pluses.
Ricky committed a foul. See if that was a lane violation. And it was, so the second free throw won't count. It's 28 to 21.
You hate to lose the gimmies. You know, games like this, when you try to play in a low-scoring game, you want to get all those easy baskets. Every little opportunity.
Leitner tried to get it inside. Budo got a hand on it, and it'll be a St. John's foul. Redmond will be their 15th foul, and it's on Chuck Sproling.
You see, a good move right here now by Muto. That was a pass. Leitner was watching out of the corner of the right side. He was trying to dump it down for a layup that time.
Ricky. Goes to the hoop. Robert Ricky now with 9 points is the leading scorer for Duke, and they've got their biggest lead of the game, 9 right now.
Ricky's looking to take you off the dribble. He's really dropping the shoulder and going strong.
Here is Seeley working in against Ricky with a baseline jumper off the side. Budo with the rebound. And Sean Budo. Now, there's not much scoring off the bench for the Redmen of the two guys, Sproling and Budo. Anything they get will be a gravy today.
See, well, Redan in there along with Budo. They have some big size to match up.
Leitner blocked in the call the foul on Redan, and that'll be number 2 on Robert.
The student body that's here from St. John in an uproar because Leitner, when he caught that ball, definitely dropped his right shoulder right into the chest of the defensive player and then had his shot blocked.
Thomas Hill back in the lineup for Duke, replacing Ala Abdelnaby, so in there for the Blue Devils. Leitner was on the line. Hurley, Hill, Bricky, and Phil Henderson. Here's Christian Leitner, second leading scorer for the Blue Devils this year. I guess he had to face a lot of comparison with Danny Ferry when he left school, saying he is the second coming of Danny Ferry.
Well, I think Coach K said this the best. You know, this ball club, not only do we have an awful lot of freshmen and sophomores that play, but we also had guys taking on new roles. And Christian is one of the main guys. And then you have Hurley on the point as a freshman. So you're asking people, you know, to step forward and play perfect basketball. And then the critics can have a field day with you if you don't deliver every night.
Redmond get it across on that trap. Under 5 minutes to go in the first half. 32 to 23. Jordan finds Budo in the lane. Second basket for Sean Budo, only averaged under 2 a game.
Sean Muto's been terrific today. Anytime that he catches, he keeps the ball up over his head. And when you're up over 6'10", that's a great advantage. Nice off touch.
Loop it in to Leitner. And they're going to get Muto, and that'll be the 17th foul. And the bonus situation is in effect for Duke. First foul on Muto.
Yeah, Lou's telling his guys, relax a little bit, relax. That was a tough ball that time. You know, they're taking Werdan out of there, giving him a blow right now. But you see, any time that you're playing big people that are moving down on the baseline side, you must have body contact, because if you do not, they're going to try to throw a lob pass. And Duke loves to throw the lob with their big people moving.
Billy Singleton replaced Werdan for St. John's. Duke is an outstanding free throw shooting team. They're all good. They're all in the high 70s or low 80s, so you won't find a weak free throw shooter.
Now, when you're looking at 76 at the college level, you know, that is really quite high.
Leitner makes the vote. The Blue Devils, by the way, were 15-2 in games outside the conference this year. Their only losses were to Syracuse and Michigan back-to-back early on. Point game. Lou Harvey feeds inside. Seeley. Here's Budo again. And they get Budo with a push off on Leitner, and they do. Second foul on Budo.
He was, you know, exasperated that time. You know, he missed a very, very easy shot on that offensive rebound. And it's too bad because we're shooting the penalty situation right now.
Abdelnaby, now he just said he's coming in for the shooter. They can bring Abdelnaby in for a forward or for Leitner, who can play center. There's a lot Duke can do with a lot of interchangeable parts on a very deep team.
Well, Mike is very happy with his nine-man rotation. He can keep coming at you with a lot of athletes, and you have to watch them. You see, they substitute so often that you have a tendency to forget who your man is. And also, you have to worry about guards moving up to the forward position.
34-25. Sproling with the ball. He's from Denver, Colorado. Up to St. John's because he saw them play in a regional out of Denver. Throws up an air ball. Leitner gets it out to Hurley. Filling the lane to Duke and runs it Ricky, but Ricky travels. But it was a fine-looking fast break till that point for Duke.
I think Ricky can really change in.
Ladder stages the first half here in Atlanta, but we have so much action coming up the rest of the day for you on CBS. Coming up next, game two, Virginia against Syracuse in the Southeast region, Texas against Purdue in the Midwest, and UCLA and Kansas in the East right here in Atlanta. And then later today, Loyola Marymount, can they keep the magic going against Michigan? A very tough test for them. Xavier and Georgetown in the Midwest and Northern Iowa against Minnesota. Northern Iowa, the big upset winners over Missouri in the first round. Abdel-Nabi back in the game. Harvey working against Hurley. Picked up by Bricky. Crashing the board is Muto. Here's Singleton, and he's fouled going up. Amazing that St. John's hanging in there despite the fact that Boo Harvey has yet to score.
Well, they keep missing the first shot in the majority of their opportunities, but they are doing an outstanding job getting on the offensive glass. And I'm kind of surprised about that because of the Duke size factor, plus the fact that the other athletes that they have are excellent jumpers.
That was the 15th foul against Duke. Obviously not a shooting situation.
See, we said at the top of the show, Boo not only has to distribute this basketball, but he's got to come in with some good numbers.
He averaged 17 a game coming in. Goes up for a three and hits it. So Boo Harvey's first basket is a big one.
Right on time. Right on time.
And on cue.
Okay.
3 minutes to go in the first half. We're still leading by six. 34-28. Henderson has Sproling in his face. Loose ball. Great hustle by Sproling. But it'll be Duke's ball as the possession arrows goes their way.
See, right now, if I'm with Duke out on the floor, I'm looking to get the ball into Abdel-Nabi.
They change that to a foul on Phil Henderson. And that's the 16th foul.
Well, excellent hustle by St. John diving on the floor to get that ball that time.
Here's Bill McCaffrey coming in, replacing Henderson, who goes out with two personal fouls and 7 points. Bricky leads the Blue Devils with nine. Seeley has nine to top St. John. So the next foul by Duke will put Redmond in the bonus. Forced that one after hitting the 3 moments ago.
See, we can't bring out enough Hurley's foot quickness. You know, his dad's team, St. Anthony's in Jersey City, are just famous for their great defense. And they've won so many state championships up there. You know, they almost retire trophies no matter what class they're in. But everything is based on foot movement, and he's doing a terrific job with Harvey.
There's the turnover. Harvey Sproling couldn't control it, but fouled it and lays it in. Chuck Sproling. And it's a four-point game.
Yeah, we've been saying this all along. They're getting good shot opportunities, but they either fumble the ball or they miss the layup.
Plus, they forced 10 turnovers. St. John's cheering section on its feet. Bricky. He's been red hot today. Bricky with 11.
See, any time that Duke attacks down inside the painted area today, something good happens. They either get fouled or they get a wide open shot to the basket.
Less than a minute and a half remaining in the first half of this game. Udo setting a screen. Hurley stays with Harvey. Double team on Harvey. Lost the ball.
Every time Boo Harvey comes off of a pick and roll or a screen, they're automatically trapping him and forcing him to give up the basketball.
Here's Bricky. And the rebound. rebound by Muto, ahead to Sproling. It's a three-on-one break. Malik Sealy with the layup. And Sealy now has 11 and is the game-high scorer tied with Brickman.
See, the element of surprise is there. Everyone in this place feels that St. John's will just walk it up. And if they'll just look down the floor, they can release one man anytime they want.
Great hustle by Sproling. Early has it in the backcourt. You're looking at the clock remaining and 24 on the shot clock on the left. McCaffrey. And they'll call Abdelnaby with the foul over the top on Sean Muto. Let's take a step back and see what we've got so far in an exciting NCAA championship. Only 12 of the top 16 seeds are left. North Carolina upset Oklahoma at the buzzer in the big shocker yesterday. Ball State, after two upsets against Oregon State and Louisville, now advancing as well in the West region. And the ACC, a school that might have been a little bit on the downside this year, so far a perfect 8-0 in the tournament.
You know, Sean Muto has really made his presence felt today. He's doing a nice job offensively. He's doing a good job blocking people out. And even when he commits fouls, they're good fouls. He's banging people around inside.
He's a 36% free throw shooter and missed the front end on the one-on-one. Down to 12-plus remaining. Duke playing for the final shot, leading by four. Here is Christian Leighton. Rebound Muto with 1 second to go. Wouldn't have counted anyway. And that is the end of the first half with the score. Duke 36 and St. John's 32. CBS Sports coverage of the NCAA Basketball Championship will continue after this message and a word from your local station.
Well, the great play of the ACC has been a big story in this tournament here on the opening weekend. And Duke out of the ACC, four up on St. John's. However, the Redmen, a 7-2 run to close the first half. Welcome you back to New York. I'm Jim Nance, and with me is Mike Francesa, who's been riding in the passenger seat on the road to the Final Four both last weekend, this weekend, and again next week. Mike has been our editorial consultant behind the scenes for the past 8 years, helping put things in perspective, and now we enjoy his insights firsthand as he comes down from behind the cameras and in the research area to right here alongside.
You know, this studio has been my home for the last 9 tournaments. It's just taking a different seat in the living room.
How about the game we're seeing right now, St. John's Duke?
Duke has done a very good job of getting the ball out of Boo Harvey's hands enough. Also, a good defense trapping Boo. Boo Harvey, since Jason Williams got hurt, has been the key for St. John's. He's 1-for-8, only 1 3-pointer. He has got to score in the second half. St. John's cannot win without a good game from Boo Harvey in the second half.
Got to ask you about Chris Jackson. We talked about him in the pregame. He's announced he's going on to the NBA. As we watched LSU against Georgia Tech, we just said, this is not the same Chris Jackson we've seen in the past.
It wasn't a great year for Chris Jackson off the sensational freshman year. Yesterday did not shoot the ball well, really never seemed to be in the flow of the game. We heard rumors that he might go pro. He's out. He'll be a lottery pick, but it was a tough year for him. They had to get the ball into the big guys a lot more this year. It was a transition year. I think he was very unhappy.
And Jackson leaves after his sophomore year at LSU. Coming up on the road to the Final Four, Virginia, Syracuse, others will see Texas, Purdue, or that UCLA, Kansas game. And then later today, most of you will see Michigan against Loyola Marymount in West Region action. The Lions, of course, are riding a crest of emotion in the wake of Hank Gather's death 2 weeks ago. And Bo Kimble, Gather's close friend and teammate, spoke about that with our Greg Gumbel following yesterday's practice session before challenging the Michigan Wolverines today.
Bo, on Friday night, the Loyola Marymount Lions gave about as emotional a performance as I think I've seen any team give. How much of it was emotion, and how much of it was the true Loyola Marymount talent?
Oh, it definitely was a lot of emotions, but most of that was due to the way we play every game and the way we've been playing all season. We play at a high intensity level, and I'm sure the emotion's going to be high when we play Michigan.
When you play Michigan, will the emotions play as big a part, or will it be back to business?
It'll be back to business, more or less. I think we'll be able to be a little bit more focused, but we want to keep that emotional state. That's been an edge for us. I think that helped us in Friday night's game. And if we keep that intensity up and keep playing the way we've been playing all year, we should be able to come out with the win.
This is where you tip it off. You guys going to be ready?
Oh, yeah, Greg. We're going to definitely be ready. We're looking forward to this opportunity. We're playing against the defending national champs. So it's definitely going to be a dandy.
Bo Kimball and Loyola Marymount against the defending champion Michigan Wolverines tip it off 4:55 Eastern time here in Long Beach.
All right, as for Michigan, they were the sentimental favorites last year when then-interim coach Steve Fisher was taking over right before the tournament. And as we sight now our first road sign of the season, we see some familiar Wolverine faces going through their tournament paces once again.
In the East Region second round matchup, the Duke Blue Devils lead the St. John's Redmen 36-32. Hubie Brown, the Redmen are staying with the Duke Blue Devils despite the fact that it looks like when Duke has the ball, they can do anything they want offensively. Hasn't been the case.
No, well, Duke already has 11 turnovers, and you got to give St. John's their due defensively. But at the other end of the floor is an interesting thing. St. John's is in this game only down four, and Boo Harvey right here, we can see every time he's coming off a pick, they're trapping him. Now you'll see they'll come at him and double team him again on the shot. Now what's happening? Boo Harvey is only 1-for-8 and St. John's is in this game. The other factor is right now, as you look at all that, and this half ended, Harvey went right to the referees and said, hey, listen, I'm getting banged on the shot.
Right, let's see if they respond. Let's take a look now at the halftime statistics. Rebounding, Duke has a 3-rebound edge on St. John's. That's good for the Redmen. They're hanging in there inside. St. John's was horrible shooting early. They're up to 44%. Duke is at 50, and Duke's backcourt is outscoring St. John's, where they have to get some points today. Leading scorers, Malik Sealy and Robert Bricky, leading their respective teams with 11 points in the game. And CBS Sports coverage of the NCAA Basketball Championship will continue after this message and a word from your local station.
NCAA Basketball Championship is sponsored by Kentucky Fried Chicken. Taste our best at Kentucky Fried Chicken. The First Brands Corporation, maker of Son of a Gun Protectant. Son of a Gun, what a difference. And by Pontiac and your local Pontiac dealer, we build excitement.
We're back in Atlanta to start the second half. Dick Stockton and Hubie Brown. Duke will inbound. Christian Leitner is up front, along with Ala Abdelnaby and Robert Bricky in the backcourt. Point guard Bobby Purley and Phil Henderson. St. John's has Harvey and Buchanan at guard. Up front, Singleton, Sealy, and Werdan.
Give St. John's defense a lot of credit, Dick. They did an excellent job forcing 11 turnovers in that first half. And But I think that Duke, if they would just go inside to the power people, can get things done a little bit better here.
They're looking that way to Abdelnaby, and Abdelnaby is fouled. It'll be a foul. St. John's has three players with two personal fouls coming into the second half. Werdan, Muto, his backup, and Boo Harvey. This foul is on Malik Sealy, his first. Werdan is all over Leighton. Ricky, staying with him is Harvey. And a foul inside, and they're going to call it against Phil Henderson, I believe. And for Henderson, it'll be his third personal foul.
He's having a very quiet day. You know, this is a guy at the top, we thought, you know, any given day, he can get you 25 to 30. And Coach K has nothing but the highest of praise for him. He thinks that he can get a shot at any time against any player.
Buchanan and Harvey were a combined 2-for-13 at halftime, but Buchanan comes out with a basket, and it's 36-34.
Now St. John guard, the opportunities have been there for them.
And Abdelnaby inside against Singleton, batted out, and it's still going to be Duke ball. You've got to give Singleton. He's been a quiet weapon inside for the Redmen.
Excellent contribution by Singleton and Sean Muto off the bench with not only the points, but 5 rebounds.
Ricky has it knocked away. Yes. And here's Harvey to Buchanan. And Buchanan will tie it up in the first 2 minutes of this second half, and a timeout called by Duke.
Very smart move that time by Boo. The steal is made. Give it up. Let the other guys run. I'll coast and rest a little bit. Nice.
We have our first tie since the game was 6-6 early on. Titus, look at this coaching condition. Hubie Brown, Chuck Daly, and Vic Bubas.
You knew we were going to get that out of mothballs, Hubie.
Oh, come on. Wow, that's what we were on the staff at Duke University way back.
Boy, did your eyes light up when we came up with it. Christian Leighton. Had it around. Abdel Nabi fights in this foul.
You know, when we came in this game today, you and I both thought two guys would be having big ones from an offensive standpoint. Boo Harvey and Christian Leighton. Leighton is still without a field goal. Boo Harvey has one. And this guy on the line right now, if they could concentrate on Ala Abdel Nabi, you know, he could cause a lot of problems here because Singleton is giving him a lot of size. He's bumping and grinding with him, but he still can't stop him once he catches the pass.
Abdel Nabi shooting the first. Meanwhile, Robert Werdan has picked up his third personal foul. So Lou Carnesecca has to make decisions in this game. And we asked him about it yesterday. He says, you know, I'm not going to end up this game losing with Werdan on the bench not fouling out. He says, I got to hang in there. So he's playing with three fouls in a game in which the Redmen trail by two.
See, Werdan, Seeley, and Boo Harvey have got to stay in this ball game for him. And he knows it. He's going to melt all the minutes that he can.
Nice side. Singleton fouled by, let's see if it was Henderson. Henderson or Bricky, and it is Henderson, and that'll be his fourth personal foul.
Wow.
So Bill Henderson, Duke's leading scorer, has to come out with four personal fouls and will be replaced by Thomas Hill, a freshman.
Now, you're scouting this game for another college that might be playing.
If you give me the job.
That's right. Yeah, okay. You know what you're impressed with today? The change of direction of the St. John players on the baseline. Think how many times that St. John's backdoored, received the pass, and either get fouled or make the layup. But more important, let's credit the people making the pass, because the passes have been right on the money.
We saw Buchanan do it a couple of times in the first half. So here is Singleton. An expressionless player. He likes to say when he comes into a game, he wears the mask. And you don't know how he's feeling. He hits the free throws to tie the game at 38. Early on here in the second half, Dick Stockton and Hubie Brown and the Redmen come out in a zone defense now.
Yes, in their 1-3-1 half-court trap. Now, what does Lou not like about this? The only thing he doesn't like is the possible three-point shot.
He likes the turnover he just
I
got.
I think he does. That's number 13 for Duke.
Redmond looking to be patient, trying to forge in front. They led it one time today at 4-3.
See, next to Boo Harvey, Werdan is the next best passer on this ball club.
Werdan going in and gives the Redmond the lead of two now, 40-38.
St. John's once again in their trap. It's a 1-3-1. Now, what are they trying to do? They're trying to force you out of your offensive set, but more important, to take those corner jump shots.
And what they're saying is, we'll give them the if, but you're going to have to make them. Another turnover. And here's a two-on-one. Buchanan and Harvey tipped away by Hill. And now they say it was last touched by Boo Harvey. So it'll be Duke ball, and St. John's missed a great two-on-one opportunity as Bill McCaffrey checks into the game, replacing Bricky.
Well, see, by McCaffrey coming in, it gives you another ball handler, another freshman, another shooter, and these two young fellas in the backcourt right now, Hurley and McCaffrey, they're going to be seeing a lot of minutes over the next three more years after
they are. And Thomas Hill is a good outside shooter against the zone defense, a good man to have in there as well. Abdel Nabi is fouled by Werdan, I believe, and that'll be four on Robert. It is. And now he's got to come out of the game. And Sean Muto, who had a fine first half for the Redmen, replaces Werdan, who goes out with four. Werdan scored 8 points. So now a lot of pressure on the shoulders of Muto, the junior from Mechanicsburg, PA, who's only lately shown that he played and given them the feeling he belongs with this group.
Yeah, but he's looking for his shots, and he's banging with his body. Now you look at in that first half right there, Muto comes in. He only gives you 4 points, but he keeps the ball alive on the offensive board, and he picks up 5 rebounds in a short period for them.
Abdel Nabi. Now in double figures with 10 points. Bricky leads them with 11. He's on the bench.
How about confidence by Coach K right now? You have three freshmen out on the floor for you.
And the score tied 40-40. And a timeout here with 17:04 remaining in the second half here in the Omni in Atlanta, Georgia.
back here at the Omni in Atlanta, Georgia. We're tied at 40-40 with just about 3 minutes going by in the second half. Out in Long Beach, the Loyola Marymount Michigan game later today on CBS. Alabama, Arizona for some of the viewers, and the survivors there will face the winners of Salt Lake City, UNLV, and Ball State. How about Ball State with upset wins over Oregon State and Louisville, advancing to the regional semifinals in Oakland next week? Boo Harvey. Abdelnaby got a piece of it, and it's still St. John's ball.
See, every time Boo goes down the lane, he's thumping the referee right now. I got hit on the hand again. Now, you see, some days you get the calls, other days they're not coming. So when you go down in there, you must have good choice of selection of shots.
Harvey hits the three. And so Boo Harvey, wide open, was 1 for 9 before hitting that shot, gives the Redmen their biggest lead of the game, 43-40.
Now, the Duke defense broke down that time. Bobby Hurley told Hill, come on, you got to switch out on that, because he got picked off on a double screen.
Leitner trying to get the ball inside against Singleton. Both Leitner and Abdelnaby have height advantages on Singleton. Abdelnaby with a fall away. Fine shot by Allah, who has now 12 points, 6 already in the second half.
If they will just continue to go down inside to Allah, they have to double team him, because he's proving today that he's scoring, and he's coming right off a great game, you know, that we saw here on Friday.
There's Harvey short on the runner, gets his own rebound, fouled in the lane. The other point is, with four personals, the Redmen can't use Werdan and Muno as much as they did in the first half.
And that's what kind of brought them back, you know, when they went to that big unit so they could bang around in there.
Foul is on Hurley, that's his second personal. There's Robert Werdan on the bench with four personals. He has scored 8. Of course, Duke has their leading score, Phil Henderson, on the bench with 4. So here's Harvey on the line. His wife, Bridget, gave birth a week ago today to his son, Greg Jr. Funny, she was a cheerleader at Andrew Jackson High School, where he went to school. That's a storybook thing. And what did Louis Carnesecca tell us yesterday? He says, you know, all my years of coaching, it's the first time I had a player who was a father.
They also have a 3-year-old child. And Coach Al Abalbo over there, his assistant, said, the funny thing about Boo, people don't understand, he's extremely coachable. He works so hard within the system, totally unselfish, and at the end of the game, is like Willie Sutton. He only stole 4 games this year with the last shot.
How many people remember the bank robber Willie Sutton of the 50s?
You know, we're bringing him back. There should probably be another movie about him.
Abdelnaby the rebound. You know, another movie. Here comes St. John's, leading by 3, 45-42. And they're going to call a foul on Christian Leitner off the ball. And for Leitner, that'll be his second personal. Team foul now, that's 4 against Duke.
See, Leitner will not allow his man to post up down in the painted area real low and close to the basket. And he will go down in there and put his body on him every single time.
Great pass from Boo Harvey to Malik Seeley. Boy, and to thread the needle through 3 or 4 players. Seeley now with 13 and a 5-point lead for the Redmen.
Very, very impressive. St. John's running so well without the ball from the other side of the floor.
Double team on McCaffrey, and the foul is on Muto, and that'll be 3 on him. So the 2 St. John centers, 1 on the bench with 4, and now Sean Muto with his 3rd.
Well, outside of the Northeast, how many areas of the country realize that St. John's gives you great half-court defense from the top of the circle back? They're man-to-man, but once you put the ball down and you start penetrating, they'll have 2 guys on you, and they're constantly covering for one another.
Brian Davis replaced Thomas Hill in the lineup for Duke. Another turnover, that's the 15th of the game. Good hustle by Muto. Pass inside to Seeley from Buchanan. And a timeout. And the St. John's fans are getting an unexpected treat.
They love that unselfish play. Now this chalkboard, here's Jason Buchanan with the basketball right now. The key guy is Malik Seeley running without the ball. Now, here we go. As Buchanan takes the ball out to the top of the circle, all right, they go for the trap. Now, watch what happens on this pass. See, Seeley, Malik is wide open for the easy layup.
Boy, they have found Seeley so many times inside in this game, Hubie. Phil Henderson playing with 4 fouls is back in there. for Duke. Sealy blocks the layup attempt. And now the Redmen again. Harvey hits it. It's 51-42. That was a two-point basket. Harvey's in double figures and a nine-point St. John's lead. And a turnaround of 18 points in this game. Duke led by nine at one time in the first half.
See, Duke has established zero offensive game from the outside perimeter today. And they continue.
Abdelnaby, baseline.
That's the guy that they have got to go to force St. John's to come back in and double team. And then that will open up their outside shooters.
Abdelnaby has 14. He is the leading scorer for Duke. Bricky also back in the lineup. His second for the Devils with 11. Here's Buchanan trying to create something. Turns it over into the hands of Bricky. Hurley has a 3-on-2 to Bricky. Goes in and they'll call the blocking foul against St. John's. And if it's on Muto, it'll be number 4 on him, and it is.
Outstanding fast break that time. I'd say Bricky runs the floor as well as any small forward around, and he's lugging a lot of weight with him. The St. John's refuses to allow you to get that uncontested layup. They take you down to the floor, and they force you to go and shoot the two foul shots.
Robert Werdan has spent a lot of time on the bench with four fouls, and now Sean Muto, the backup center, also has four. So a big dilemma for Lou Carnesecca here as Bricky prepares for the two shots. Bricky, a 70% free throw shooter.
His senior year in high school, the North Carolina High School Player of the Year. Real outspoken senior leader on this ball club.
Plenty of time remaining, nearly 14 minutes. Bricky misses a both. The rebound by Muto, who stays in the game with four fouls. Henderson also in there for the Blue Devils, playing with four.
Well, Duke has got to turn up their defense right now and cause some A, turnovers, but more important, B, some bad shot selection.
Harvey. Rebound Hurley. There is Bricky again. Misses the slam. Harvey is hit by Abdelnaby, and they'll call Allo with the personal foul. I believe there was a collision on the loose ball. And apparently not.
We are blocked out over here. We had the referee standing right in front of us.
Steal on the inbound pass. Buchanan. 53-44. St. John's in front. They were down by four at halftime.
Hey, the fast break has been there all day for St. John. When they first the turnover, just look up the floor. They're getting 2-on-1 almost every time.
Hurley is left open for the three. And Bobby Hurley, with his first three-point basket, now has 7 in the game.
See, he can score, and he's got to start looking for the shot to get the players out. Then they can go down inside.
Section. It's 55-47 and a really startling event because Duke was the favorite coming in. Abdelnaby goes up and is fouled by Malik Sealy, only his second foul. And for St. John's, their 16th foul. One more and it'll be bonus time for Duke.
Abdelnaby has demonstrated presence today in the post area. And when you do that, the defensive team must come back and double team you. And if you have any kind of power move, which he is showing us, he's going to get the good shot, and he's been making the one open one. More important, they've been fouling him, putting him on the line.
Abdelnaby, Bricky, Henderson, all senior starters for Duke. They have played a key role in the Duke season. They started off 22-4 and then lost 4 of their last 6. Prior to their victory over Richmond. Here's a team that's gotten to the Final Four 3 of the last 4 years and all at East Rutherford, New Jersey. And that's where they'd be headed to advance the cause this year if they win today's game. Right now, the Redmen lead by 7.
Box him out, Phil. Box him out. Get 2 on there. Let's go, Red. Box him out.
The rebound, Singleton. and a half remaining in the second half here. Dick Stockton and Hubie Brown in Atlanta, the East Region, second round action. Here's Seeley, tipped up by Muto, singled him, lost the ball to Bricky. Just took the ball away from two Redmen.
You gotta love St. John's. They have three guys on the glass. Excellent play by Bricky.
Driving in is Brian Davis. Just a sophomore, and they think he may get up to 6'10". He's 6'6 right now. And Duke now comes back trailing by five.
Well, you have to tighten it up right now. And Duke can do that. They've done it in the past. They've been in this type of game, you know, many, many years.
Malik Seeley. Good pass. Rejected by Davis. Singleton went up, and Brian Davis knocked it away.
You'll see Malik Seeley here. Going to make a strong move. There it is. There's a pass. Pump fake, and there is the reject.
Brian Davis with the reject. Meanwhile, Christian Laettner has replaced Ala Abdelnaby, who goes out with 15. He is the high scorer for Duke. Harvey and Hurley, they've been the matchup all game. Harvey missed, and a foul inside against Duke. Maybe against Brian Davis. In any event, it'll be the 15th foul against the Blue Devils. We're at the Omni in Atlanta, Georgia. Connecticut and Clemson advanced in the East Region yesterday in Hartford, and today two winners will join them in East Rutherford. Dick Stockton and Hubie Brown. St. John's leading Duke in a surprise, 55-50, early midway through the second half. Finding the open man, Jason Buchanan is open. Buchanan now with 10 points.
See, he's a forgotten man today. Anytime there's penetration, he's open on the wing.
Laettner comes back, rebound Bricky. And Bricky's fouled. Tell you, Robert Bricky has been the player of the game for the Duke Blue Devils. He has kept them in there at both ends.
Well, he's played big. He just got away with a push that time. Put a St. John guy right into the stanchion. That's why he became open on that rebound.
Malik Seeley with his third foul, and that's the 17th foul against St. John. So Duke is in the bonus now. Seeley with 15 leading the Redmen. They have Harvey and Buchanan each with 10.
Box him up.
The biggest surprise to you in this game so far?
Well, first of all, the fact that Bobby Hurley has been able to almost negate Boo off the dribble. That's for open. Number two, the St. John's defense enforcing so many turnovers.
It'll be St. John's ball off the leg of Brian Davis.
That is an excellent call. I mean, people here are all upset, but you know, that ball really went off the good player's leg.
And we had a good view of it. Buchanan and Harvey at guard, Seeley, Singleton, and Sean Muto. They're the turnovers.
When you show full court pressure right now, they want the ball in Boo's hands because it's a zone press.
And here's the turnover. It worked.
First time today they caused the turnover on that track.
Bricky. Laettner. Foul. And it'll be Singleton. And that'll be his second. Mike Krzyzewski, who said his team lost the edge after winning too much early with a lot of young players. Question is, have they regained it?
Well, the big thing is the defense. He thought that they lost the intensity from the defensive end of the floor, and by that he meant decision-making also. Decisions, when to switch, when to double, things of that nature, and then also out in the open floor. And, you know, he said that then the seniors came back, and they did an excellent job in turning this ball club around.
Laettner misses a free throw. He came in with at 84% from the line, and he has yet to hit a field goal. He's 0 for 6 from the field. So Christian Laettner needs to get a little on track here in this game. And once again, here is the trap by Duke.
You remember we said earlier, St. John's does not like to break the press and score. They like to break the press, bring it back out, and run clock on you.
St. John's by five. And a reach-in foul. Once again, Malik Seeley was lurking inside, and a Duke foul will be their 16th foul.
He is having, Dick, such a wonderful day playing without the basketball. You know, a lot of kids, they say, hey, I don't have the ball. I want to dribble the air out. Malik Seely is showing you today, running without the ball, sacrificing so he gets shots.
Singleton on the inbound pass. By the way, that foul was on Leitner, his third. And it's 59-52 St. John's. Leitner still empty from the field in this game. And the Redmen trying to build on a 7-point lead. They had it up to 9 earlier here in the second half. They'll play the winner of Kansas and UCLA to follow here at the Omni. Harvey. Muto gets the rebound. Seely fights for the loose ball, but Duke has it.
Give Bobby Hurley credit. That Boo's last two drives, he's been right in front of him. Just a chance.
Leitner. And the foul against St. John. It'll be Singleton, his third. Coming up next on CBS. Tremendous action. Virginia, the ACC against Big East Syracuse. Some of you will see Texas and Purdue. And UCLA against Kansas, second seed. Later on, Loyola Marymount, after their win over New Mexico State, now faces Michigan, the defending national champs. Xavier against Georgetown in Northern Iowa. One of the Cinderellas still alive will be going against Minnesota.
It's off.
When you get to crunch time at playoffs, whatever level of basketball, you expect your best players to step forward and assume the pressure in the last 8 to 10 minutes of a ball game. And this fella on the line right now, Christian Leitner, he's the guy that's got to get up here and start scoring some points and rebounding.
He has missed 3 free throws, which is quite unusual for Leitner. St. John's leading by 6. And the Redmen, of course, brimming with confidence as this game goes on. Seely goes up. Loose ball. Hurley out of the pack. As Davis and Seely hit the deck. And now they'll call a foul on Muto, and that'll be it. Sean Muto is fouled out of the game.
Very clever move by Bobby Hurley that time by cutting, not right in front of the defensive player, Sean Muto, but enough whereby Muto could not stop, and then he fell right over him.
He fouls out, having scored 6 points, but 10 rebounds to keep St. John's strong off the boards. Muto is out of the game. Right now, Robert Werdan is up, and Chucky Sproling. And I wonder whether Carnesecca is going to wait before bringing Werdan back in.
Still too early for that, Dick. You have 9.5 minutes to go.
They're going to leave Werdan on the bench.
Well, you're sitting with a 6-point lead right now. Naturally, they're shooting on the foul line, but Lewis trying to buy some time by bringing in Sproling, play him up front. He's 6'6". He's an excellent leaper, and Lou Fields is a very, very tough kid on the boards and will give him some good defense.
So Sean Muto fouls out. Werdan, the starting center, on the bench with 4, and Chucky Sproling, who is 6'6", but can get up there, replaces him. So more pressure now perhaps on Singleton and Seely. Seely's the tallest of the group at 6'8". Missed the free throw. Sproling, who's got quickness now.
Now this puts a lot of pressure now on the young, on the small front line of St. John's, with Singleton.
Oh, steal by Ricky, and it's taken away by Harvey on the interception. Boo Harvey. And he misses in the lane, and Ricky loses it out of bounds. Back and forth they go. You don't know when they're not going to in this game. You don't know what you'll miss.
Duke at its best, denying the wing pass, a steal, definite layup at the other end of the floor. Boo Harvey, sensational anticipation.
And the Redmen wind up with it as we wind down to 9 minutes to go in the second half. Give and go, Sproling from Seely. Well executed. And St. John's is up now by 8, 61-53.
St. John's does all the little things. Back direct dodge, give and go basketball.
How about another turnover? And taken away by Duke, and a foul against Sproling. One team has it, then the other. And let's watch the sweater man, Louie, in action.
Louie, do your thing. Louie's auditioning. Look, a little jump, and a twist, and going the other way. You're right, Lou, you got it. Hey, yes, come on. Good job. And you know, you look at Lou. Here he is.
is in his 22nd year, 16 times in the NCAA tournament, 6 times in the NIT. A fantastic record. Technical foul was called against Billy Singleton, and Robert Bricky will be on the line, shooting 2, and Duke will maintain possession. Foul was on Sproling, but Singleton, I guess he took off that mask that he likes to wear. This is St. John's tempo, emphasizing their excellent half-court defense. Then it comes down to frustrating the opposition by running the clock. Everything for Duke must come from their defensive end of the clock. And here is the free throw, the 2 technicals, and then the 2 shots. When Bricky was up, could end up being as much as a 7-point play if Duke makes a 3 in their possession.
Well, when you're in a situation like this as a coach, you're in a hostile crowd area. You do not want to lose control of the silence of your audience. And right now, these people are jacked up. They've closed the gap to 4. They sense that they can make a comeback. Big possession right now.
Against the small St. John's team. Henderson. Abdelnaby is there. He's done it all day inside. Abdelnaby with 17 points. And it's down to a 2-point game. 61-59. Timeout, St. John's. Leading Duke 61-59. Technical foul really hurt the Redmen. UConn and Clemson won yesterday, and they'll move on to the Meadowlands against the winners here. The winner of this game and the winner of the next game coming up here between UCLA and Kansas. Those 4 will go to East Rutherford for the East Regional semifinals and final. Let's see how St. John's responds from the technical foul. 6 points run off in a row by Duke. They call a foul against the Blue Devils here. And that'll be the 17th foul. So now both teams are in the bonus. There's the shooting story per half. Bricky with his 2nd person.
This has been an excellent battle all day today. Bricky versus Sealy. You know, they're hurting one another at the offensive end of the floor by scoring a number of points for their ball club.
Sealy is a 75% shooter from the line. You know, I think a lot of words have been used to describe Malik Sealy, the sophomore from the Bronx, and Louis Carnesecca said he's always there, he listens unemotional, dignified. You know, you hear that word said about him, and that's the way he conducts himself on and off the court.
Well, he's got the entire package. He has the talent. He's going to get bigger. He is a true small forward. He's coachable, and he has a great aptitude for the game.
63-59. St. John's led by 8. And Duke ran off 6 in a row on that technical foul situation. Hurley open in the corner. Bricky now with 18. He and Abdelnaby have combined for 35 of Duke's 61 points.
It just seems that every time Sealy scores, Bricky scores at the other end. Excellent matchup today.
2-point game. St. John's in front. 7:45 to play in the 2nd half.
Everything above the foul line area now, looking for the cutters. It's almost like a delay game type. What you're trying to do is hit the wings and dribble, cut to the basket.
Keep in mind, we're Dan on the bench, and he's another card that Carnesecca can use before this game is over. Sure he will. Will Harvey with a 3. He was lunging forward, but behind the line. That's right, Louie. He's got 3 and 13 in the game for Harvey.
Just like you teach. Straight up on your shot. Nice release.
He was horizontal when he let that go. 5-point lead for St. John with 7 minutes now remaining in the 2nd half. And
Johnson's Duke playing their game right now, tempo-wise. Throws it away. Henderson into the hands of Sears.
Jason Buchanan has Henderson elevated. Buchanan got a piece of that ball, disrupted it right into a turnover.
19 turnovers by the Blue Devils today. So unlike them. And the clock slowly getting into St. John's territory.
See, Sealy's trying to help Singleton out here.
Knocked away, it's still Duke ball.
Abdel Nabi is creating double coverage down inside there. Interesting, they're taking him out right now for Christian Leitner's coming into the ballgame.
Leitner comes in along with Bill McCaffrey. As Abdel Nabi goes out, having scored 17 points, Ricky, their leading scorer with 18, stays in. Hurley fires a three and hits. Bill Hurley now with his second three-point bomb. And that cuts the lead to four.
No surprise to the Duke coaching staff. Bobby Hurley Jr. is blessed with a lot of talent.
Who thought St. John's can hang in the game like this with a lead with Werdan on the bench close to the second half with four fouls and the backup Muto out of the game with five? Using the clock. Big East, of course, prepares you for every eventuality.
That time Duke gave you a matchup. It's a matchup 2-3 zone because see, they're trying to take away the cutters to the basket.
Harvey with 5 seconds on the clock, fouled by Hurley. And that ball very nearly made the hoop. For Hurley, that's his third foul.
See, that was an interesting move by Duke that time. They went to a 2-3 matchup. They gave you a man-to-man look and frustrated St. John's because the cutters were not open going through the zone.
Bill Henderson will come in, replacing Brian Davis. Davis goes out having scored 2 points. If I had told you today that the St. John's bench would outscore the Duke bench, you'd think I was nuts, huh?
Yeah, I think that the majority of people would take you up on that.
But that's been the case.
See, Louis right on the sideline now. You're up 5 points, shooting another one. You have 5.5 minutes to go. You have your own philosophy of when you bring back in a guy with five fouls. Coaches differ on this, you know. Right, you're with four fouls so that he'll play, and hopefully he'll play well for you before he gets that last foul. But each coach differs on this. A lot of guys put him back with 7 minutes, 8 minutes. Some guys will say, hey, I'm going to milk it. Why? Because I'm ahead.
He has that luxury. They had Sproling on the foul, so Phil Henderson will go to the free throw line. Henderson, one of the good free throw shooters, at over 82%. So here's Phil Henderson. He's a guy who called his teammates a bunch of babies, and that was unlike him. He's been a quiet guy throughout his career, certainly not vocal. And I think his players respected him. You know, he almost transferred to Illinois during the summer. He's from out there. And then he couldn't because of grades and some sort of technicality. And Krzyzewski said to the teammates, if they want you back, Henderson can come back, and they gave the okay.
Well, I think it was the correct decision, not only by the team, but by the coaching staff, because he's rewarded them with an outstanding season. But I like what Henderson said after that outburst, and that was, the players on this team do not have to live up to my standards. If you have goals in life, you have to find a way to reach them yourself. Very well put.
Pretty well said. Brian Davis replaces Henderson. Here comes the three-quarter pressure by Duke, trailing by three now. 5 minutes remaining in the second half.
Duke is back out of the zone now. A little matchup that they have playing man-to-man. Defensive player chasing in a situation like this, you're saying, please don't let my man
back court. Please don't let him get away. Buchanan. Rebound Leitner. And now Duke trailing by three. The outlet to Brian Davis. Davis goes up. And the a one-point game. Duke coming back. They trailed by 9 in the second half. And now they're down 69-68.
Duke team hitting the floor with their palms. That's their signal for a defensive stop.
And Robert Werdane is at the scorer's table, and Louis is going to bring him back at the next dead ball. Now under 4 minutes to go. Harvey working it against McCaffrey. Goes up and is fouled by McCaffrey. And will go to the line. Robert Werdane is coming back into the game with 4 personal fouls. Werdane has scored 8 points, and the Redmen are going to need him off the boards and offensively before this one's over.
Now, he's sat a long time, but when you're playing delay game, he's in there at the defensive end of the floor to board for you, help on the post. But most important, we said at the top, next to Boo Harvey, the best passer on this basketball team. Now, how about Boo Harvey's move? That was a great spin move, splitting the trap to get off that shot attempt.
Misses the free throw, and an 81% free throw shooter has missed 2 in a row. And he's got one of them. 70-68. McCaffrey out, Hurley back in at point guard. Sproling did a good job while he was in there.
Now remember, both teams are in the penalty situation now.
Henderson from the corner. I think it was a 2. It was, and they're tied at 70. 70 all with 3.5 remaining in Atlanta. Buchanan. Off and the rebound by Davis. We want to welcome those who have just joined us to the Omni in Atlanta, Georgia. We're in the final stages of the second round East Region battle between St. John's and Duke. The Redmen, who have led most of the second half, have seen the Blue Devils come back to tie it up at 70. Dick Stockton and Hubie Brown, what kind of game has it been?
Well, from a Duke situation, their inside game has been great. They came back with outstanding defense and a player like Henderson finally getting hot when they needed it.
13 for Henderson, their leading scorer. Now, what about St. John's and their strategy?
Well, St. John's have just cut apart Duke's defense with all kinds of running without the ball, backdoor moves, outstanding passing, and now Werdane's come back. They need him right now from here to the end.
But a turnover. Werdane couldn't find Singleton. 2:28 remaining, and Duke leading by 2. They have the ball. Both teams are in the bonus.
John's defense has been outstanding today, forcing Duke into close to 15 turnovers.
Henderson for 3, tipped away by Singleton, and it's still Duke's ball. Duke led by 9 in the first half. St. John's took a 9-point lead of their own in the second half. Shooting has been near even. The backcourt scoring, where all eyes were focused, has been even. Sean Muto, the backup center for St. John's, is fouled out. And Werdane, the center for the Redmen, playing with 4, as is Phil Henderson of Duke.
This has been a great matchup today, Bobby Hurley versus Boo Harvey at both ends of the floor.
Under 2 minutes remaining, 1:51 to go. Very big possession here. 20 seconds on the shot clock.
Werdane really fighting hard to deny that pass down inside to Christian Leighton at 7 seconds.
And Hurley, now working in the lane, fires it up. And he gets his own rebound, passes inside to Leighton. And it's going to be St. John's ball. It was last touched by Leighton.
What a great pass.
Timeouts remaining. No fouls to give in the possession arrow in St. John's favor as Brian Davis has come back in the game. Abdelnaby came out. 72-70. Duke leads. That's Boo Harvey. Gets fouled.
a terrific move by Boo Harvey. Bobby Hurley played him as well as you could. He took that shot up to its height, brought it down, and then extended. That was an outstanding move in order to create the foul on Hurley.
Four on Hurley, and here comes great Boo Harvey, the senior from St. Albans, New York, who has missed two of his last four free throws. These are big ones. One more to tie.
And I remember in this situation, we only have a minute and 6 seconds to go. Duke has two timeouts left. St. John's, one.
Abdel Nabi replaces Brian Davis. Abdel Nabi has been a horse inside offensively for Duke.
They have not been able to stop him. He's either been able to score down inside or get fouled. Duke going with the two giants down in the pivot there with Christian Laettner and Abdel Nabi.
And a timeout called by Duke, so they have only one left. Will we come back to the Omni for the finish? To go in this second round battle here in Atlanta between favorite Duke and St. John's. Each team with one timeout left. Both teams are in the bonus. St. John's has a possession arrow. There's the foul story. Werdan has four. Henderson and Hurley of Duke. Their starting guards have four. And already Sean Muto has fouled out for the Redmen. 38 seconds on the shot clock for the Blue Devils.
Let's see if they go down inside.
Abdel Nabi's been their big man throughout the game inside.
Werdan doing an excellent job in denying, playing on trying to front. Now he's fronting Christian Laettner down inside.
Still plenty of time on the shot clock. Here's Abdel Nabi making his move, and it's picked up and in by Bricky. It was a layup by Bricky, who has 20 points now on Duke leads by two.
Yeah, that's frustrating when you're on defense. You get the shot blocked, and then the other team gets the ball back and lays it in.
Well, what a game for Bricky today. Werdan in the corner now to Harvey. This is the jumper. Hurley has it for Duke, and they can run out the clock. And a foul on Bricky with 9 seconds to go. Robert Bricky will go to the line.
Now, right now, Coach K is talking things over right now. What you're trying to do with your guards is to pass the message to the other people. What happens if he misses the first part of this and the ball is in play? We are ahead by two. And there's 9 seconds to go here. Now, if he makes one, we are ahead by three. You must pick up, and we have to be alert not to give St. John's a three-point opportunity. So Coach K immediately grabs Henderson and Hurley, got him over on the side. Just explain the situation, go out on the floor and tell the other guys.
And a timeout has been called by St. John's. We're back here in Atlanta. Duke leading St. John's 74-72. St. John's called a timeout. They have none left. And Robert Bricky will go to the line to shoot 1-1. And, of course, Mike Krzyzewski is thinking, what happens if a miss? You explain that situation. And if they do, St. John's has Harvey, who has hit three game winners and sent another into overtime. He's been an 11th arrow hero for the Redmen this year. But let's see what Bricky does.
Now, St. John's, you must put a body on Christian Laettner right now. And if he misses, get that offensive foot right. But they did an excellent job. Put a body where they blocked him out. Now, Louis sitting here right now, and he knows he's down three. Naturally, this is a key in the ball game. You only have 9 seconds to go and no timeouts left.
Bricky, 7 of 11 from the line. And they're going to let the clock run out. The game is over. Duke wins and advances.
Great, great comeback by Duke.
Thank you. try, but Duke, trailing by 9 in the second half, comes back and wins and will move on to East Rutherford, which has been a charm for them in the Eastern Regional. They'll play the winner of the game coming up between UCLA and Kansas. And Malik Sealy of St. John's and Robert Bricky are the Chevrolet players of the game. 6-72, Duke wins. Dick Stockton and Hubie Brown, let's send it back to our New York studios in Jim Nance. Jim?